It was supposed to be their year. A season that started off with such high expectations.
I can't believe the news today. Oh, I can't close my eyes and make it go away. Sunday, bloody Sunday. Yeah. Sunday, bloody
It's week 17, the NFL on CBS, wrapping up the regular season. We've got the Denver Broncos and the Indianapolis Colts from the RCA Dome. The kickoff is next. Back in Indy, Jim Mora has one more year left on a five-year contract. We spoke with him yesterday. He said, I'd like to come back under the right circumstances, but he and management have not spoken about the situation as of yet, something they'll deal with after the season ends, and we'll talk about it at great length here today. And Mike Shanahan, you want to talk about rumors? There are rumors swirling regarding Shanahan and the University of Florida after Steve Spurrier announced his resignation earlier in the week. I'll tell you what Coach Shanahan had to say to us yesterday as we move along here today. Vanderjack, the kickoff. Chris Cole on the return for Denver. And he crosses the 25-yard line, brought down by Jason Doering after the return of 23 yards. Brian Griese has to have a big day today if he wants to top 3,000 yards for the season. He's 324 yards away from doing that. He went over 3,000 back in 1999. He's put up pretty good numbers, but the interceptions have been higher than in the past.
Yeah, Brian Griese said that they're going to come out and open it up against this Indianapolis Colts defense, giving up the most points in the National Football League, so they're looking to finish this season on a good note.
So Denver opens up with a first and 10 at the 30-yard line. Play fake. Greasy will throw it on first down. On a dump off, could not make the connection to Tony Carter, the fullback. It's incomplete. Let's take a look at this Denver offense, and across the offensive line, they have played at such a high level through the years. Teague, Friedman, Nalen, Neal, and Lepsis. But no Pro Bowlers this season. They do have some alternates. Backs and receivers, Terrell Davis. Talk about the conjecture that's out there regarding Davis, and we'll cover that. Carter in the backfield with Rod Smith going to the Pro Bowl again. Rookie Kevin Casper and Dwayne Carswell, the tight end. On second and down, Greasy fires and intercepted. Jeff Burris on the second play from scrimmage, looking for the angle, and he's forced out of bounds. Greasy picked off. Burris with his third interception of the year.
This isn't the start that Brian Griese was looking for. He gets a little antsy. He's waiting for the fullback, Tony Carter, number 37, to get his head around. But see, he turns up the field, and the ball is already released. Burris just playing and reading the eyes of the quarterback, Brian Griese. But certainly Carter was not on the same page. You can see his back is to the quarterback, never sees the ball coming. And Burris makes the play and gets the interception. Big plays have been rare for this defense all season long. But now they've given the offense an opportunity to get off to a fast start.
Turnover ratio, it's been night and day for these two teams. Denver came in as a plus 13 and Indianapolis at minus 15. So look at the field position that Peyton Manning has on a first and 10 from the 11. Two tight end set. Hand it off. Dominique Rhodes cuts through a hole and gains 2 yards along that right side. John Mobley with a stop for Denver. For Manning, he's looking to go over 4,000 yards for the third consecutive year.
And Peyton Manning, yeah, he's looking to finish on a good note as well. He says, we don't want to go into the offseason with that bad taste in our mouths. Of course, he's looking to have some big plays himself today. And he's had a really good year, except for the interceptions. That's where he's gotten himself into trouble.
But he did say it's been a humbling experience for him, considering what the expectation level was this year after going to the playoffs in each of the last 2 years. On second and 8, Manning guns it. Incomplete. It was Rhodes just short of the goal line, and Al Wilson wrapped him up. It'll be third down for Indy.
Attempting to throw the ball down in the red zone on the crossing route to Dominique Rhodes. Pressure was coming in on Peyton Manning, but this is a ball that should be caught. ball is thrown a little bit behind Rhodes, but certainly hits him in the hands. Had an opportunity to make the catch, but Al Wilson was there to at least make the tackle.
Dominique Rhodes stepping in for the injured Edgerrin James. He does have 32 catches this year, and he has done the job on the ground, inching closer to the 1,000-yard mark. Shotgun. Indy looking to get on the board first. Manning underneath. Dilger turning and will come up short. Takes it to the 4-yard line. John Mobley with a stop 5 yards through the air, and the Colts will have to settle for a field goal attempt.
It's just good defense. They're in a zone coverage here, and that's all they're doing is just keeping everything in front. Mobley comes up to make the tackle. Manning, I'm sure, wanting to take a shot deep in the end zone, not really happy with the fact they have to settle for a field goal. Blown opportunity there to put some points on the board in the form of a touchdown.
Had a first and 10 from the 11. And they picked up only 7 yards. 22-yard attempt for Mike Vanderjagt. And Vanderjagt puts it through. Colts off the turnover. Take a 3-0 lead here in the first quarter. We'll return to the RCA Dome after this. Indianapolis in front 3-0. This Colts team has dropped 7 of its last 8 games, and they are just 2-5 here at home at the RCA Dome.
And it's their inability to prevent turning the ball over on offense and then giving up big plays on the defense that have seen them have a disappointing season.
Chris Cole couldn't handle it initially. Cole scoops it up and gets it out to the 15-yard line. Mistake by Cole on the return. Clifton Crosby makes the stop after a 13-yard run back. So Greasy will get another shot at this Indianapolis defense, a defense that has given up gobs and gobs of points this year. Colts lost last week 42-17, 476 points allowed, highest total in the NFL. Terrell Davis, they sniffed it out. Behind the line of scrimmage, Bratsky and Washington combined. It's a 3-yard loss. Indianapolis defense comes in ranked 30th in the NFL, and across that defensive line, Scioli, Williams, Johnson, and Bratsky. Linebackers, some changes because of injury. Washington is the mainstay. Sword is in for Morris, and Ryan Phillips gets the start for Mike Peterson. And the secondary, some youngsters there. Burris is the veteran. Cota also a veteran, but Bashir and Macklin are learning on the job.
They are learning on the job, and they've given up big plays, as you said before.
Davis, no hole for Davis to run through. And the Colts cut him down, no gain. Ryan Phillips involved in the stop for Indy.
Terrell Davis, we spoke to him yesterday. He says, I'm just happy to be healthy. Of course, we also asked him about his future with the Denver Broncos. He said, I hadn't really thought about it until a week ago when someone brought it to my attention. He says, I'm just going to play hard and try to finish out, showing myself what I can do. He said, I'm not trying to prove anything to anyone else. I want to prove to myself that I can get back to my old form and continue to be productive and help us win.
He did say his choice would be to stay in Denver, but he knows it's going to be at a new rate. Greasy has the time, flings it to the sideline, and intercepted. Raymond Walls, the rookie, with his first NFL pick.
And what a play by Walls, because he was in man-to-man coverage, and he makes a break, gets his head around, and he picks off the ball. Here you see he's in coverage against Scotty Montgomery, another rookie. He comes out of the break. Look, the head turns around. He closes on the ball, and that's just really a good job by Raymond Walls, out fighting the receiver for the football. And it's just a timing route. The second interception thrown by Greasy so far today is 17th on the year, and few plays have been made by this defense. They had come in with 11 interceptions, tied for the fewest in the National Football League. Already have 2 interceptions in the first quarter.
Second time the offense has touched the ball, first at the 11-yard line, and now they take over from the Denver 23. Manning. Incomplete. Reggie Hayward was putting some heat on Peyton Manning in the pocket.
Yeah, Manning said, he said, they're going to come after me. Last week they saw the film of the Denver Broncos coming after Rich Gannon and the Oakland Raiders. They like to crowd the line of scrimmage with 7 or 8 defenders and put a guy in each gap. You don't quite know who's going to come. It really confuses the offensive line in terms of their blocking assignments. Very difficult for the quarterback to get the reads. He's got to get rid of the ball very quickly to avoid taking a lot of hits today.
They do have the top-rated pass offense in the AFC. And the running game has stabilized with Rhodes. It's not Edgerrin James, but Rhodes has done his job. And here's Rhodes. cutting through an opening, and Rhodes with a 5-yard gain. Ryan Deem on that right side with a key block. Deem is a part of this offensive line. They've been impressed with Deem, the rookie out of Northern Illinois. Glenn McKinney, Saturday and Meadows, the rest of the guys up front. Backs and receivers. Rhodes trying to become the first undrafted free agent rookie to go over 1,000 yards in a season. Pollard, Wayne getting the start for the injured Terrence Wilkins. Harrison and Dilger round out the skill positions for Tom Moore's offensive unit. Now a 3rd and 5 from the 18. Checking off his man. Dilger in the backfield. There was some movement there. And it's going to work against Indianapolis.
Yeah, there you see the delay of game, and that's because they crowd the line of scrimmage, the Denver Broncos defense.
Prior to the snap, false start, 33 offense. 5-yard penalty, remains 3rd down.
Ron Winter, our referee here today, it's called on Rhodes. Denver defense, Trevor Price is going to the Pro Bowl once again, although his numbers have not been as good as they have been in the past. Mobley, Wilson, and Romanowski, good linebacking core. Will Romanowski be a salary cap casualty next year? And Delta O'Neal going to the Pro Bowl at cornerback. Denard Walker on the other side with Brown and Kennedy, the safeties. So it turns into a 3rd down and 10 for Indy. Manning out of the shotgun. Rush is coming. Manning looking for it all. Harrison the grab. Touchdown, Colts.
And what a play by Peyton Manning, because he was under pressure. He stood in the pocket, was able to step up, gave him enough time to step up in the pocket and find his number one target. Marvin Harrison just doing an excellent job, having a really big year. You can see he's coming, just going outside, right in between the cornerback and the safety. He gets inside number 27, Denard Walker. You have to ask, did he get both feet down?
Well, that's exactly what Mike Shanahan is asking right now. Marvin Harrison, the catch made. You see the left toe, and it's pretty clear.
It's pretty clear. He only got the left foot down. The call was premature.
Denver's challenge of ruling on a field, but the pass is complete for a touchdown.
It was a bang-bang moment. And on slow-motion instant replay, it's pretty obvious.
Yeah, he only gets the left foot down. You watch as we slow it down for you. Only the left foot will come down. He's not able to drag that right foot. That's an easy call right there. No touchdown. And enough evidence from the pictures we saw there to overturn the call on the field.
It was a 3rd down, so they'd be looking now at a 40 or 41-yard field goal if this play is overturned. Harrison thought he had his 14th touchdown of the season. Manning was hoping that it was his 25th touchdown of the season. And Jim Morris certainly was looking for a 10-0 lead.
Yeah, this is third straight season that Harrison has had 100 receptions. So he's had a big year despite some of the fall-offs from the Indianapolis Colts, only checking in with a 5-10 record. But his productivity has remained very high for the Colts offense.
That's quite an achievement, too. 100 receptions, 3 straight years. Only 2 other guys have done it, Jerry Rice and Herman Moore of the Lions. Ron Winter has seen enough. And here is his ruling.
After reviewing the play, the receiver did not get 2 feet down in bounds after controlling the ball. The pass is incomplete. Denver is not charged with a timeout.
Winter did not take much time to take a look at it, so it was fairly obvious that he saw it right away. And here's Manning telling those guys on the sideline, hey, let's get going.
Let's get going. Let's snap the ball and kick the extra point before they're able to review it. He knows that there's a chance that that touchdown could be taken off the board because Marvin Harrison was only able to get 1 foot in the end zone.
So Indy has the 3-0 lead. They can make it 6-0 now with Mike Vanderjagt. A 41-yard attempt. Hunter Smith will hold it. Justin Snow will snap it for Indy. Easy come, easy go for the Colts, who appear to be on the verge of taking a 10-0 lead. Vanderjagt made one from 22 yards away. This is a 41-yard attempt. And he splits the uprights. Indianapolis 6. Denver nothing. 2 Brian Greasy interceptions have led to 2 Mike Vanderjagt field goals. snowfall, which began overnight here in Indianapolis, continues into the afternoon, and the Colts lead the Denver Broncos 6-0. Still in the first quarter. Kicking it off, Vander Jack, who has accounted for all six of the Colts' points. Cole on the return from the six. Here's Cole looking for a lane. And spun down at the 31-yard line by Jim Finn on special teams. A 25-yard run back for Chris Cole.
And now the Broncos have to come out and try to reestablish themselves. They're very fortunate in the fact they've thrown the two interceptions, but have only allowed 6 points in the football game. Of course, a score, a touchdown, will give them the lead. So they have to really, I think, collect themselves and get the offense going, try to establish the running game. And with Terrell Davis and Brian Greasy has to do a better job of protecting the football.
They do not have a positive play from scrimmage, and Mike Anderson has checked in at running back. Play fake. Greasy to throw again. There's the completion to Tony Carter, who is nudged out of bounds by Phillips. Short of the first down, they'll give him a gain of 8. Well, Indianapolis, the story has been pretty simple this year. Offensively, they can compete with anyone. In fact, Mike Shanahan said this is the best offense they have seen all year. Defensively, well, the numbers tell the story.
Yeah, great disparity between what the offense is doing in terms of their productivity and just the poor performance of the defense. But really, the offense has put that defense in a bind by turning the ball over. The defense haven't responded in sudden change situations.
Second and two. Greasy loses the football. No whistle as Greasy is forced to go all the way back to the 14 to get it. That one just slipped out of his hands.
And Brian Greasy is all out of sorts to start this ball game. He starts to throw the ball to the left side of the field, try to pull it back down, and when he does, the ball comes out. It is a fumble, so he has to go back and recover it. This ball's going to be at the 15-yard line. You see, second-guessing himself, tries to pull it back down and loses the football. Brian Greasy just doesn't seem himself to start this football game. What a poor start here in the first quarter.
That is a 24-yard mistake by Greasy. Denver on a 3rd and 26. Greasy steps up, fires across the middle. Rod Smith trying to create after the catch. And Smith accelerates to the 28-yard line. That is short of the original line of scrimmage. 13-yard gain, Washington the tackle.
Rod Smith has just been the reliable receiver all season long with the loss of Ed McCaffrey. He'll just slip underneath the coverage. The linebackers are dropping back so far. There's so much room for Rod Smith. Of course, he picks up a nice game, but nevertheless, they have to punt the football on third down. Good defense by the Colts.
Tom Ruin comes in averaging over 45 yards per punt. Trevor Inslee returning in for the injured Terrence Wilkins. Inslee from the 21. Inslee's got some room down the sideline. Here's Trevor Inslee crossing midfield and into Denver territory. Indianapolis with good field position again. It's been a nightmare of a start for Greasy. Colts lead 6-0. Trevor Inslee, longest punt return in his young NFL career, 33 yards. And for the third consecutive possession, Indianapolis is starting on Denver's side of the field. So another short field for the Colts offense to work with.
And the Colts are doing a good job on defense and have to begin to take advantage of this good field position on offense. Try to put more points on the board than just field goals, because you know this Broncos offense is going to get going sooner or later.
Rhodes in the backfield on a 1st and 10, 8:31 to go in the first quarter. Play action, and they fake the trickery. Manning to Rhodes, makes the catch at the 30, and then angles out of bounds at the 26-yard line. Reggie Wayne was the man who came into the backfield, and Manning faked it to. And then Rhodes was the recipient on the near sideline.
And this is where Dominique Rhodes, he has not been a drop-off since Edgerrin James has left the game because of his ability to catch the ball. Now they're going to go with the no-huddle offense for the Indianapolis Colts.
19 yards, longest reception of the season for Rhodes. Now he'll get the carry on the ground, and he is bunched up. A loss on the play is Chester McLaughlin. Read it perfectly, and Rhodes loses a yard.
And that's where Rhodes says he's taken a page from the book of Edgerrin James. He says when you're running the stretch play, he said Edgerrin has really told me what I should do is have to race all the way to the sideline and try to get the defense to overrun it a little bit, leave myself some room to cut back. That time, Chester McLaughlin was able to take away the cutback lane from Dominique Rhodes.
How many people knew the name Dominique Rhodes coming into this NFL season? A rookie out of Midwest Texas State, a Division II school. Play fake. Manning has the time, looking for it all, to the end zone, and knocked away. Kanoy Kennedy, the strong safety, in his second year from Arkansas, getting a piece of it. Marvin Harrison, the intended target.
Mike Shanahan said, we have to be aware of the play action pass. You see Kennedy stays back on the play. He's able to get up and show his good vertical jump and able to make a play on the ball. Just excellent play by the safety, Kennedy, because they had a good sale on the play action fake. One of the best in the business is Peyton Manning was able to disguise the pass, but Kennedy was able to stay back and stayed on his keys and able to make a play.
Now a third and 12. Pollard sets up as a receiver on the near side. Play clock is winding down. Shotgun for Manning. Steps up and throws, looking again for the end zone, and knocked away by O'Neal. Another youngster in that defensive backfield in his second year out of California, and he's going to the Pro Bowl because he's got 8 interceptions this season.
Yeah, this ball is thrown behind the receiver. O'Neal still able to make a play. This ball has to be over the top, allow the ball to get over the top of McNeil where Harrison can make a play. This ball was thrown a little flat that time by Peyton Manning. If he had it over to do again, I'm sure he would have gotten more air under the ball to allow Harrison to make a play on it.
45-yard field goal attempt for Vanderjagt. Already connected on two, and you can make it three. Colts take a 9-0 lead. Vanderjagt now has 117 points on the season. A few mistakes by Brian Greasy, 2 turnovers, and a fumble that pinned Denver back. So Indianapolis with excellent field position here in the first quarter, and Mike Vanderjagt with 3 field goals. He kicks it off for the Colts. Chris Cole has had a workout here in the first quarter. Another return for him from the 4. Cole with a head of steam. Couldn't squeeze through the hole, and he is brought down just short of the 29 by Jason Doran. You learn more from a season like this than from the one that they had last year when they went to the playoffs.
He also said that during the offseason he's going to take a look at every tape of every play of each game and, you know, go through some self-analysis and try to critique his game to try to make the improvements needed to be successful.
Hand off. Davis bouncing off the tackler and then brought down at the 35-yard line. That's a gain of 7. Matt Lepsis with a block on that right side to help get some extra space for Davis to work through.
And whenever your quarterback is struggling, that's what you have to do. Come out and run behind the big offensive lineman. Do a good job in that zone blocking scheme. And Carswell, you see he's doing a good job also blocking, and Matt Lepps is opening up the running lane right off the left tackle for Terrell Davis to pick up the game.
Total yards, Denver has just gotten into the positive column with that carry from Davis. He'll get another try at it. Could not push the pile, and just about everybody involved for the Colts defensively. It'll be a gain of 1 for Terrell Davis. And that's the question. If you're Denver, do you believe that Terrell Davis can regain that form that made him an MVP back in 1998, over 2,000 yards rushing?
I think if he can have an offseason where he's going to get the rest that's needed, where he's not spending his time in rehabilitation or recovering from a surgery, I think during an offseason where he gets complete rest, I think he can get his legs back under him, and I think he can continue to be productive. May not be the Terrell of old, but he can continue to be a productive running back for the ball for the Broncos.
On 3rd and 2, Davis diving ahead. He's got the first down to the 40-yard line. He needed 2, and he got 4. That's the one thing he really focused on in our conversation with him. We said, what's the difference between the Terrell Davis of a few years ago and the Terrell Davis of now? He said flat out, it's the legs. I just don't have the strength this time of year that I was used to.
That's right. He spent the last 3 seasons just rehabilitating from surgery, trying to get himself into shape. And then, of course, when you're playing games, it's just a lot of work on his legs, and he hasn't had time to rest.
On 1st down, it's Mike Anderson getting the call, and Anderson able to churn the legs for a gain of 4. Chad Cota, part of the Indianapolis Colts defense, to make that stop on Anderson. And that's the other question as well. If you're Denver, do you believe that Anderson is an everyday number one running back where you can let a Terrell Davis go?
I think you saw that last year from Mike Anderson. The numbers he put up as a rookie, over 1,000 yards behind this offensive line in their zone blocking scheme. He certainly can be productive and carry the ball for 1,000 yards and be an every down back as well.
And he is their leading rusher this season because Davis has been banged up. All the running backs have been banged up, including Olandis Gary. It's a gain of 3. Josh Williams, first man there for Indianapolis. You take a look at the running backs, and you can talk about the system because they always seem to get that 1,000-yard rusher. This is going to be the first time that they do not have a 1,000-yard rusher since 1994, and here's the salary cap situation coming up.
Yeah, that's because all three have been banged up this year, but you could see next year, Terrell Davis, he may be a salary cap casualty. Mike Anderson, his number is safe, but if you go to Olandis Gary, he's a free agent at the end of the year. He may be gone.
On 3rd and 3, they convert it to a first down. Rod Smith in Colts territory inside the 45. Corey Bird with the coverage. And it's a pass and catch of 9 yards.
Rod Smith came in 4th in the AFC with 25 third down receptions. So not only has he made the big plays, but he's been the go-to guy on third down to keep the chains moving for this offense. He's so versatile, his ability to create on the big play. He can catch underneath, go over the middle, but he's also instrumental in helping in the blocking in the running game. So he's a complete receiver.
5 straight 1,000-yard seasons for Smith. He's going to the Pro Bowl for the 2nd straight year. Greasy on a scramble. Tripped up. Brian Greasy could not break free of Chad Bratsky. A sack for Bratsky, a loss of 4. He's got 6.5 sacks on the season now.
And Bratsky told us yesterday, he said, we continue to work hard. It has been a disappointing season, but we'll play hard because we practice hard. And you can see they've come out and they're trying to win this game. They want to go home with a good taste in their mouths. He said, but that's the thing. He said, Jim Moore, we continue to support him because he has maintained discipline. He said, and he has the respect of every player on the roster.
A 4-receiver look. On a 2nd and 14, Greasy guns it, caught in stride by Smith, and brought down after another Denver first down short of the 30-yard line, 15 yards through the air.
Rod Smith starting to get going, working against number 42, Raymond Walls. It's just a quick seam route, and he gets separation because of the speed, and he's able to beat the jam at the line of scrimmage. Walls doesn't get the bump and doesn't disrupt the timing of the play, and that's why you see Rod Smith is just off to the races after making the catch.
Rod Smith on the season, it's a franchise record, 108 catches for Smith. Davis, stutter step, through a hole. Davis remaining on his feet inside the 20. And Burris had to get him down low to bring him to the turf. Ellis Johnson whiffed on a tackle attempt. 13-yard gain for Davis.
Now, is this just the defense being generous, or is this Davis really running like we know he can? You see the cut, good vision, and you see him accelerate through the hole, then bouncing it outside and really dragging Jeff Barris, number 20, after contact. And that's what Terrell Davis, you can see, starting to get back in the flow of things, played in 4 consecutive games for the first time since his injury in 99.
Anderson has spun down at the 10. And one note for Terrell Davis. He has just become the all-time leading Denver Bronco in rushing attempts, passing Floyd Little. So despite all the injuries over the last few years, Terrell Davis has carved out a couple of records in team history in recent weeks.
And last week he became the all-time leading rusher for the Denver Broncos, passing Floyd Little as well. So I think they may be able to work something out to keep this guy around because he's such a leader in the locker room as well.
Anderson on a 2nd and 2. And he picks up 3 yards. It's a first down. It'll be 1st and goal inside the 10 for this Denver offense. And here comes Davis back into the game with time trickling away now in the first quarter. Indianapolis leading it 9-0. Could be a lot worse for Denver.
Yeah, it could be a lot worse. They've turned the ball over, but now they're starting to get it going. It all started with the running game. Terrell Davis, Mike Anderson, of course, this offensive line, one of the best in the National Football League for the last 5 to 6 years. Their zone blocking scheme continues to be consistent and very productive.
1st and goal from the 7. Davis tripped up, remains on his feet, surging to the goal line. Did he get there? No. Sam Sword with a tackle, and he just saved 6.
You know, we talk about him being the all-time leading rusher for the Broncos, but this is sort of an audition for Terrell Davis to be able to show that he still has it, what it takes. You see him putting the hand down and getting the extra yards when it appears as though there's no room, but he has been so productive over the years. This is last week against the Raiders where he had a really good game. Came up, and since they, actually his last touchdown, he hasn't scored a touchdown all year. So this is last year against the Raiders.
So Terrell Davis will have an opportunity at it as the second quarter gets underway. 9-0, Indy leading Denver. We'll head to the second quarter. Back to the RCA Dome after these words, the NFL on CBS. Ian Eagle, Solomon Wilcox, the rest of our CBS crew from Indy. The Colts leading the Broncos 9-0 as we start play in the second quarter. A 12-play, 70-yard drive thus far for Denver. And Terrell Davis still looking for his first touchdown of the season. He's got 7 carries, 28 yards.
9 rushes, 3 passes on this drive, so it's all been done with the running game.
Second and goal. Play fake. Greasy to the end zone. Caught by Clark. Touchdown, Broncos.
And it was the play fake and play action. They fake it to Terrell Davis. That's what allows the tight ends to get open. Clark just wide open. Never did anyone cover him coming off the line of scrimmage. See the play fake. He comes off the left side. He's just wide open. Linebacker cannot get back. That's number 54. He can't get over to make the play.
23rd touchdown of the season for Greasy. He has a touchdown pass in all 15 games that he's played this year. Extra point from Jason Elam. And despite all the first quarter miscues, Denver trailing Indianapolis by only 2. It's 9-7 Colts, early second. Desmond Clark has joined elite tight end company this season. Names like Gonzalez, Sharp, and Chamberlain. He's fourth among tight ends in receiving yards and catches. Clark has his 6th touchdown of the year. One thing that is common among those names, other than Gonzalez, all of them have played for Denver.
Clark's 47 receptions are 2nd of the Denver Broncos behind the receiver, Rod Smith.
Kevin McDougal, just short of the 35. 1st and 10 for Indianapolis. They had a 9-0 lead. Now it's 9-7 as we start things off here in the second quarter. Handoff, Dominique Rhodes. Rhodes running into a wall as he crossed the 40-yard line, but he did pick up 7 yards on the sprint. Al Wilson with a tackle for Denver.
Rhodes is a player that, you know, he's happy to have this opportunity to play. This is his 10th consecutive start. He's shown that he can take advantage of that opportunity. Been very productive.
He was just hoping to make this team. He said that was the hardest part, coming into training camp and just trying to improve himself. On 2nd and 3, short toss. Harrison's got a 1st down and a juke move into Denver territory and down to the 48-yard line. That's 10 yards. Manning to Harrison.
And the defense, they just leave Marvin Harrison all by himself. You see the tight end just pulls everyone with him. That's Ken Dilger. And then everyone just leaves Harrison. He has any room to make the catch and pick up yards afterwards.
It's just not fair for a linebacker to have to deal with Harrison in the open field. 92 consecutive games now that Harrison has come up with at least 1 catch. Give it off to Rhodes. Turning the corner. Rhodes accelerating across the 45. 5-yard gain for Rhodes as he inches closer and closer to 1,000 yards on the season. Eric Brown with the stop. Rhodes came in 37 yards short. And now he needs 20 yards. He's got 5 carries, 17 yards today.
It's been a real luxury that they haven't had to change the scheme or the way that they play on offense with the loss of Edgerrin James, because he stepped in and he's able to do everything that Edgerrin James is able to do in this offense as well.
Here's Manning now checking off the line of scrimmage. 2nd and 5 from the 43 of Denver. Colts leading at 9-7. Pump fake. Manning steps up. Manning looking to run and slides down at the 40-yard line. Jerry Johnson was grabbing at the jersey from behind. It's a 3-yard scramble for Peyton Manning.
Yeah, the defense very active getting after Peyton Manning, but this is where Manning is making the improvements earlier this season. You see the pump fake. Well, he would have tried to force this ball in there, but he eats it. You know what? It's okay to have to punt the football. Of course, it's 3rd and short, so they're going to get another shot, but he did not force the play. Therefore, he prevented the turnover.
Went to the line of scrimmage quickly on 3rd and 2. Quick throws. To the sideline, Harrison diving for the 1st down. Good individual effort. Ian Gold tried to bring him down. It turns into a 3-yard gain. They needed two, and Harrison knew exactly where the marker was.
Just a hitch route to the receiver. Wide receiver screen coming back underneath. He's able to break the tackle and get up the field. It's just a really good play. Second effort breaking the tackle of Ian Gold. But Harrison's just so productive. He could do it all. Catch the ball for the big plays, and he's also able to run after the catch.
He's got over 1,400 yards receiving. On the toss back, Manning looking for it all into double coverage. Intercepted. Eric Brown was tipping Delta O'Neal. Brings it in.
Yeah, O'Neal gets his 9th interception on the year. And this ball should not have been thrown because they stayed back. Both the safety, Kennedy and O'Neal, had this play covered. It was a play action. He should have never thrown the ball. Should have gotten rid of it. It's intercepted by Delta O'Neal.
O'Neal making history. 9th interception of the season in his second year.
For play action pass, here's you want to key. You want to key the offensive guard to see if he's going to fire up the field. He doesn't. That's a run. That's a pass block all the way. And the defensive backs, they stay back on and make the play.
On first down for Denver, Desmond Clark turning it upfield and comes up just short of the 30-yard line. That's a 9-yard gain. Adrees Bashir with the coverage on the tight end Clark. We mentioned the history for O'Neal. 9th interception this season. He has become the 4th Bronco with 9 or more in a season. Goose Gonsolin, Tyrone Braxton, Willie Brown, the other 3 names in Bronco history.
He was a first-round pick a year ago and starting to pay huge dividends for this defense.
First down run for Terrell Davis, and he gets a little extra. Up to the 35-yard line, Tom Nalen with a block. New set of downs for the Broncos. We go to New York. Jim Nance.
All right, Ian, I know you've got nasty conditions outside there in Indianapolis and decaying conditions in Pittsburgh, but the Steelers tie it on Fu'umatu Ma'afala's run. 7-7, second quarter. Back to Ian and Solomon.
I think any broadcaster worth his weight in salt will tell you they want the challenge of saying Fu'umatu Ma'afala.
Chris, Fu'umatu Ma'afala, the Polynesian.
Yep. And Mr. Nance nailed
it. That's right. He nailed it every time.
Up the middle for Davis. 1-yard gain. Brad Scioli with the tackle. We're going back to Jim in New York. Another NFL Today update.
All right. Thank you, guys. This one a little easier. Antoine Smith. 10-0 Patriots looking for more. Not so easy. He coughs it up. Mike Minter recovers. It remains 10-0. Patriots trying to clinch the AFC East. And let's go back to you.
And Jim, that's the amazing part of the AFC East. There is still a chance that the New York Jets could have the number 2 seed in the AFC in a first-round bye. Incredible. Greasy home run ball in the double coverage. And Chris Cole cannot come up with it. They were looking for the big gainer with Macklin and Bashir deep.
Well, they had an opportunity to get it because Greasy airs this one out. He had Macklin beat. Cole's, you'll see, he'll get on top of the free safety, but Dries, and that ball gets in there, and he's not able to make the reception. That ball hit him right in the numbers because he's able to get on top of the free safety and the cornerback. The ball made it in there. Good throw by Greasy that time. Cole's have to come down with the ball.
A lot of inexperience at wide receiver once McCaffrey went down. Casper's a rookie. Montgomery's in his second year. Cole's in his second year. On third and long, incomplete over the middle. Rod Smith, normally a ball that he just sucks into his body and then takes off with, but this one falls to the turf.
And had he caught it, would have ran for the first down because there was plenty of room. The linebackers for the Colts had really dropped off. And right now, Mike Shanahan can't believe his football team because they've gotten off to an inauspicious start, not really coming out and hitting on all cylinders because they've had the opportunities and haven't taken advantage of them.
Tom Ruin punting to Trevor Inslee, who had the 33-yard return earlier in the first quarter. Good punt from Ruin. Contact was made. Inslee couldn't catch it. Free football inside the 10. And it's whistled down at the 10. Kevin Casper was looking to run it in. He thought maybe it had touched a Colt. Willie Middlebrooks, did he make contact with Inslee is the question.
There is no foul on the play because a teammate of the receiver was blocked into the man making the catch. There is no foul. The kick was illegally touched. First down.
Yeah, Macklin is knocked into his own man.
So the Indianapolis Colts get pinned back inside their own 15. Ah, the choices at Shapiro's Deli here in Indianapolis. The choices on offense for Peyton Manning. He's got Pro Bowler Marvin Harrison and the young rookie Dominic Rhodes, who gets the call. And Rhodes takes it to the 14-yard line. John Mobley with a one-on-one stop. Four-yard gain.
Yeah, Inslee is back to return on the punt. And watch, you can see Middleton just pushed David Macklin right into Inslee, but the ball never touched anyone. So at this point, he downed the football right there inside the 10-yard line.
Call it a second and a short seven. Manning. A sidearm toss, and it was very low in the direction of Reggie Wayne. Now the Colts have the clock stopped with 9:16 to go in the second quarter. They lead 9-7, and they face a third down.
Yeah, with the pressure bearing down that time on Peyton Manning, he's just trying to get rid of the football and wanted Reggie Wayne, the rookie wide receiver, to react more quickly and break off this pattern. That time, Wayne wasn't prepared for the ball to arrive, and that time Manning just wanted to get rid of it, didn't want to take the hit. Very smart play by Manning.
After the play, Rhodes and Romanowski were jawing at one another. The young rookie taking on the energetic veteran, Peyton Manning. Wobbling throw, bobbled, and caught out on the far side. It's a first down for Harrison and the Colts. 11-yard gain.
And Harrison right now seems to be the only receiver on the same page with Peyton Manning. They have the bunch formation. He'll just break this one right outside. Denard Walker is not able to get over in time. In fact, he even gives Harrison enough time to bobble the ball and still make the reception.
So a new set of downs for this Indianapolis offense. Here's Rhodes, long drive. He's got a hold. Dominique Rhodes across the 40-yard line. 16-yard gain for Rhodes. Marcus Pollard, the tight end, with a key block.
And there had to be a breakdown in the Broncos defense because Rhodes, he found plenty of room. You see, he's just 1 yard shy of becoming the first undrafted rookie running back to top 1,000 yards.
On a first and 10 from the 41. This drive continues for Indianapolis. Rhodes gets the call. Rhodes cracks 1,000 yards in his rookie season out of Midwest Texas State. This kid was an intern for the Dallas Cowboys not so long ago. The NFL as a player didn't seem realistic. But Dominique Rhodes stepping in for the injured Edgerrin James. And he becomes the third Colt rookie to ever go 1,000 yards in his first year. James and Marshall Faulk, the other two.
Shows you what you can do when you hang around and work really hard to get the opportunity. You have to perform well. Build a career for yourself in the National Football League.
Second and 6, Pollard. And he steps out of bounds in Denver territory at the 46-yard line. That's a 9-yard gain. And another first down for Indianapolis. You see what Faulk did as a rookie in a Colts uniform. James just put up huge numbers in his first season. And Dominique Rhodes, over 1,000. Choice company.
Dominique Rhodes doesn't have any illusions. He says, hey, this is Edgerrin James' football team. It'll be his job when he comes back next year.
There will be no controversy at the running back position. Handoff, Rhodes. But one thing you do is open eyes around the NFL. And that free agency comes around sooner or later. 5-yard gain for Rhodes. And right now, he's just got to get into a mindset of being a part of the NFL, contributing any way he can next year, whether it's a backup or as a kick returner, and he basically told us that.
That's right. He says, and you know what, even if I can split some time and share time in the backfield with Edgerrin James, I'm willing to do that. He knows his role on this football team.
Rhodes, good patience. And he turned something from nothing. It's a gain of 3. Kennedy and Washington combining to make that stop for Denver.
And Edgerrin talked to him about having patience and allowing the offensive line to flow and sometimes allowing the defense to over-pursue, allowing room to cut back. And it's been a good student learning from Edgerrin James. 48 yards rushing on the day on 10 carries. It's better than 4 yards pop, so he's having himself a pretty good day.
On 3rd and 3, McDougal has stepped in for Rhodes. Shotgun for Manning. Rush is coming. Manning unloads it. Complete. Marvin Harrison making the catch, and Peyton Manning has just passed 4,000 yards for the third consecutive year. He is the third man in NFL history to do it. Marino and Fouts, the other two.
A lot of history being said here today at the RCA Dome. Peyton Manning's, of course, a big student of the game and following the company, the likes of Dan Fouts and Dan Marino. I guess your name had to be Dan to be in that, that group prior to Peyton Manning joining it, but certainly off to a fast start early in his career.
Give it off to McDougal. And not much there for Kevin McDougal. Al Wilson with the tackle. It's a 3-yard gain. Now for Manning, we asked him, you're ready for this season to be over and turn the page? He said, hey, if I had my druthers, I wish I could turn back the clock and start over.
It was so disappointing. You see the 23 interceptions this year, one so far here today. He wished he did have it over to do. He wished he had the healthy receivers, of course, with Jerome Payton going out. Says, hey, we can still play with the best of them. Of course, the offense ranked second in National Football League.
Second and 7, McDougal gets another carry. Trying to utilize his blockers, and he actually almost made a tackle on Marvin Harrison. It's a 5-yard gain. It'll be third and short upcoming. McDougal now in his second year out of Colorado State.
Of course, if Manny could do it all over again, he would like to have more help on the defensive side of the ball. It's the offense that really, I think, ranks high with any team in the National Football League. The improvements have to come on the other side of the ball during the offseason.
One thing he did talk about is trying to get Reggie Wayne a touchdown in this game. The rookie out of Miami is yet to taste the end zone. Manny on a toss. Harrison turns it inside and takes it in untouched. Touchdown, Indianapolis, 20 yards, Manning to Harrison.
Well, this was easy because, you know, Delta O'Neal has 9 interceptions. He makes big plays, but he also gives up big plays as well because he has to come up and make this tackle. This is just pass and catch over to Marvin Harrison. You can see O'Neal just has to come up and make this tackle because when you miss it and get faked out like that, just an easy touchdown for Harrison to just walk in the end zone. I don't think it's ever been that easy at all for Harrison throughout his career.
O'Neal bit on that fake toward the sideline, and then Harrison went in for the score. 12 plays, 89 yards. Vander Jack the extra point. Indianapolis extends the lead at 16-7 over Denver in the second quarter. Marvin Harrison was denied his 14th touchdown of the season in the first quarter when an instant replay showed that he was not in bounds. This time he gets it. Manning to Harrison. And Indianapolis in front, 16-7. Kickoff from Vander Jack. Chris Cole from the 5. And Cole is driven back. Couldn't quite get to the 25-yard line. Chuki Nacori with a special team stop. Denver on offense when we return to Indy. This was a game originally scheduled for September the 16th back in week 2. And of course, with the tragic events that took place in New York City back on September 11th, NFL postponed the week, tacked it on at the end of the regular season. Peyton Manning told us back in that week they figured that Denver was a team that they would see down the road, meaning playoff time. It couldn't work out that way. Greasy on first down. Greasy knocked up in the air and intercepted. Ryan Phillips. Third pick of the day for Greasy. Tony Carter, the intended receiver.
Again, it's the second time he was trying to go to Tony Carter where the ball ended up in the hand of the Indianapolis Colts. You see number 37, he'll check out to the flat here. This ball will hit him right in the chest. Greasy goes to him. Look at this ball right off the shoulders, right into the hands of Ryan Phillips, who knows what to do with it. Just an easy interception off the shoulder pad of Carter. But they've been out of sorts pretty much for most of the day in their ability to try to pass the football. The running game has worked, but whenever they've gone to the air, you see 3 interceptions by Brian Greasy. They've yet to really get going in that phase of the football game.
First interception of the season for Phillips. And Greasy, those numbers subpar today. An even 4-minute mark now of the second quarter. Manning, a first and goal situation from the 9. Handed off, Dominique Rhodes spilled out, and no gain on the play. He lost the ball late. Thought the play had been whistled dead, though, and let's see. Trevor Price wrapping it up.
I tell you, he was down, but we didn't hear a whistle. He was hit by number 51 Mobley as he went down. He was on the ground. Let's see if he's actually down by contact before the ball came out. You can see he's going down. Then the ball comes out.
Reggie Hayward.
Recovered by Denver.
Whoa, Reggie Hayward on the recovery. Pricer was the one that came down on top of Rhodes.
And Jim Morris trying to get word from his coaches. He's throwing out the red flag now. Let's take a look at it. Watch number 51 right here. John Mobley's going to come and get the hit on Rhodes. He's go down. See, he's down. Then that ball comes out. I have to believe that he was down.
Yeah, but we've run into this situation before, Solomon, this season where the whistle is not blown.
See there?
Indianapolis has challenged a ruling on the field with the runner fumbling the ball prior to being down in contact.
Now, we saw the glancing blow by John Mobley, who comes across the top and hits Dominique Rhodes. Then he hits the ground, and then the ball comes out. But when you watch it full speed with sound, it's very difficult to tell. Quick it happens. And now you hear the whistle blowing very late. There was no whistle when he hit the ground until the ball came out way later. Then you hear the whistle. So the whistle came really late after the play.
Almost seems simultaneous as he was falling down to the ground. I think that's the question they have to answer here. Was the ball jarred loose before he hit the deck?
Okay, there you see the ball's in. Now he hits the ground, then the ball comes out. I think that's very clear. I think you see the glancing blow by Mobley across the top of the head, then he hits the ground, and then the ball comes out.
You're saying it's very clear that Indianapolis should hold on to the football?
From the pictures we saw just there, it's certain. Now, was it enough for the officials to see? And it's really up to them. Very objective. Of course, they interpret things quite differently. But from how I saw it, the sequence of events, you had the hit by Mobley, then you had Dominique Rhodes hitting the ground, and then you had the ball come out.
You got a mixture of defensive players and offensive players on the field right now for Denver. The Indy offense has gone back onto the field after the ruling was that Denver had recovered the fumble.
Now there's a glancing blow, and then you see him hit the ground. He still has the ball after the hit by Mobley. And then once he hits the ground, then the ball comes out.
I can tell you from a play-by-play standpoint, calling it live, I did not think it was a fumble.
After reviewing the play, with the ball in his possession, the right forearm of the ball carrier hit the ground, and the ball came out. The runner is down by contact at the 9-yard line. Ball belongs to Indianapolis. Indianapolis is not charged with a timeout.
So no timeout charged here after Jim Mora allows himself a smile here in the second quarter.
And this is just a case of instant replay really helping the officials to get it right, because it was tough for them to see from this angle. His back is turned to the officials at that point, and we saw it happen at full speed, and it was very difficult to tell when, in reality, when it happened, because it happened so quickly.
On a second and goal now for this Indianapolis offense. Manning, quick throw inside the five. Reggie Wayne is pushed out of bounds. Denard Walker with the coverage on that far side, 5 yards through the air.
Marcus Pollard was in the air when the ball went to Reggie Wayne. Have to wonder if there was some confusion on the play. Peyton Manning wasn't happy, looking to get Wayne into the end zone for his first touchdown of his rookie season.
So the line of scrimmage will be just inside the four. Colts were actually at 19% on coaches' challenges this season, last in the NFL. They keep that stat.
Well, we've had a much higher rate than that, you and I.
Oh, I think so. I don't know if they keep the stat for announcers. Low throw, and it's incomplete. Harrison, the intended target, so Indianapolis will attempt a field goal. Fans booing here, wanting to see this Colts offense go for a touchdown. Yeah. That's silly.
You know, this is just a bad throw, because you saw Harrison was open. Just get the ball right into his chest. Instead, it goes to his feet and into the turf. I'm sure Peyton Manning wishes he had that throw over as he comes off and talks to the offensive coordinator, Tom Moore.
It's a chippy for Vanderjack, 21 yards. And he knocks it through. Colts with a 19-7 lead over Denver. They have put points on the board off of turnovers and just haven't turned them into touchdowns. We're late in the second quarter. Coming up, Nextel Halftime Report. Jim, Mike, Randy, and Jerry will have the scores and highlights and a report from the Jets-Raiders game. Second half of the CBS doubleheader. That's coming up on the Nextel Halftime Report. From the RCA Dome, Colts with a 19-7 advantage over Denver. Three Brian Greasy interceptions. Manning has been picked off once. Dominique Rhodes has gone over 1,000 yards on the season. Peyton Manning has gone over 4,000 yards on the season. Indy kicks it off. Chris Cole on the return, and a crowd of players across the 30-yard line.
You have to wonder if the Colts are allowing the Broncos to hang around, because after the three interceptions by Greasy, Colts have only converted for three field goals.
Terrell Davis cutting it upfield and spun down short of the 40-yard line. 8-yard gain for Davis.
As we get close to the 2-minute warning, you have to wonder if the Broncos are going to be content to go back to the running game. Whenever they try to get it going in the passing game, bad things have happened. Whenever they given the ball to Terrell Davis, well, they've been able to manufacture some run yards and been able to move the chains, and that's how they've been able to put the one touchdown on the board that they have.
Call the motion man on a 2nd and 2. Davis hurdling his way for a first down. As we hit the 2-minute warning, Denver will have it, a 1st and 10 at the 47-yard line when we come back. Each team has all three timeouts remaining. With 2 minutes to go in the first half, Indianapolis with a 19-7 lead on the Denver Broncos. Broncos are 1st and 10 at their own 47.
And the Broncos are starting to attack with the running game, because I believe their offensive line can take over this football game if they continue to stick with Terrell Davis.
Broncos trying to finish the year at 9-7. Greasy under a rush, loses the football, and scooped up by Byrd. Was he ruled down? Will it be a sack at the 41 as Jeff Burris knocked it free?
Well, they're saying he was ruled down, but we've already said that bad things happen when they've attempted to throw the football. You see, Greasy doesn't see the blitz coming. He holds on to the ball.
Forward, but he was contacted by the defensive player. That rule, that's an incomplete pass.
So an incomplete pass, and Denver does catch a break there.
And Greasy's got to get rid of the football. He has to see the free blitzer coming in. He had an opportunity to get rid of it, held onto the ball way too long that time.
2nd and 10 now from the 47. They lose no yardage. Rush is coming again. Greasy. A short toss to Desmond Clark, who is brought down in Indy territory after the gain of 5 by Sword.
Now you see the hit on Greasy. Now watch this. Did the ball come out? Well, the arm was coming forward after the hit, so it's ruled an incomplete pass.
I'm with you. Very close.
You know what? I'm not sure if the jolt he took made the arm come forward.
Right. Was he throwing
the
football?
It's almost like a whiplash effect. I think the ball was actually back when he hit. I have to change my mind and go back. It's almost like a whiplash effect. He gets hit, then the arm starts to come forward as a result of the hit. Then the ball comes out.
But you're asking officials to make determinations like that.
Very
tough to do.
I'm not asking them to make that.
Not you, but in general.
Absolutely. Very, very difficult to tell under those circumstances, but the arm was actually moving forward when the ball came out in the technical sense.
Agreed. Now, whether or not it was on his own volition, only Brian Greasy knows.
Absolutely.
On a 3rd and 5, 48-yard line, the line of scrimmage, Coleman in the backfield, Greasy a deep drop, fires up, almost picked off, Chad Cota. Second man in was sprinting towards the football. Scotty Montgomery was the intended receiver across the middle.
You know, so much has been said about the fact that Jim Mora may not return to this football team, but his players are really playing hard today. They're attacking the Denver Broncos, playing good pass coverage there by Jeff Burris and Chad Cota, going after the ball, diving for it. We talked to these players yesterday. They said, you know what, we're practicing hard. We have not given up. We've come out and played hard in every game. That's the respect that they have for Jim Mora. And that's a really good measuring sign to see if a coach still can affect a good positive performance from his football team, and he's getting it here today.
Trevor Inslee, a fair catch is made at the 12-yard line. They'll probably spot it just short of the 13. Don't forget, Nextel Halftime Report is coming up. Jim, Mike, Randy, and Jerry will have the scores and highlights and a report from the Jets-Raiders game. It's coming up on the Nextel Halftime Report. And we spoke with Jim Moore about the incident early in the year with Peyton Manning. And he said, I messed up. He basically came out and said it. Not in those words, but use your imagination.
Absolutely. And he said that, you know, I'm as close with Peyton Manning as I've been with any player that I've ever coached. He's known Peyton Manning since he was a kid growing up in New Orleans when Jim Moore coached the Saints. His dad, Archie Manning, was a radio analyst for the Saints. So they've known one another for a number of years and have been able to repair the relationship.
Handoff, Dominique Rhodes, and Rhodes leaves his feet across the 20-yard line. Tarik Glenn on that left side with a block. And yeah, with Moore, I think there is this perception right now around the league that, well, Peyton Manning soured on Moore. Manning had the same things to say regarding Jim Moore. He likes the discipline and the respect factor.
Fully support his coach, absolutely, and they maintain some discipline because the offense continue to operate at a very high level, ranked second in the National Football League. They know the problems are really with the personnel on the defensive side of the ball. I don't think the problem stems from Jim Moore.
Timeout taken with 1:07 to go in the second quarter. Indianapolis will have a first down at the 28 when we come back. Indianapolis with the lead on Denver, and it could be a lot more than a 12-point disparity after the Colts settled for field goals instead of touchdowns following Denver turnovers. Just over a minute to go, first half. Manning trying to set up the screen and cannot, over the head of Rhodes. Incomplete. 1:02 left on the clock, and Peyton Manning had something to say after the pass.
Yeah, Peyton Manning, you know, he doesn't want to take that extra hit. You know he's suffered from that broken jaw earlier this season against the Miami Dolphins. Of course, just recently he's been able to eat, said that he'd gone out and wanted some steak, but he doesn't want to take any shots. And he's really upset that the fact he wasn't able to get that ball down to Dominique Rhodes on the screen.
Well, he was craving steak, as he told us. He's now able to chew it, so he's savoring every moment of it after eating through a straw for so long. Shotgun, trying to quick hit it. Incomplete, and the timing just was not there. Insley, the intended receiver. Only 2 seconds come off the clock with 1 minute now left in the second quarter and a 3rd and 10.
You know, Peyton Manning's such a bright quarterback, such an energetic person. But sometimes, you know, he comes, I think he moves maybe a little too fast for the rest of the football team. He's operating at such a high level, and sometimes the timing is thrown off because he's so quick, so anxious to get rid of the ball and make a play. He wants to do it all himself. Jim Moore says, you know what, you have to rely on your teammates and allow them to help you make plays.
You see the third down situation for Indianapolis today. 4 out of 8. Rush is coming. Manning floats one to the sideline in the direction of Insley. Incomplete, and Indianapolis is forced to punt. The problem now is Denver has plenty of time left on that clock with 2 timeouts remaining.
And again,
56 seconds to go.
He overthrows Insley on that play, and we see on the series of play 3 consecutive plays where Manny can't quite get the ball to the wide open receiver. And I think those are some of the moments where he has to calm down the adrenaline and really play within himself, because he's capable of making those throws. Sometimes he gets a little too energetic, becomes too anxious to make the play.
They did not use much of that clock, and now Hunter Smith is called upon to punt for Indy. Delta O'Neal is deep. Short punt. O'Neal lets it bounce high in the air. Able to field it. Looking for room, and there's nothing there to work with. And he is tackled down at the 31. Clifton Crosby, first man down the field. A 44-yard punt and a 4-yard return for O'Neal. So Brian Greasy, 7 of 15 throwing the football, 61 yards. He does have the 1 touchdown to Desmond Clark and the 3 picks today, raising his season total to 18 interceptions on the season.
Now the 3 interceptions have hurt you. They've hurt this football team because it's meant 9 points to the Colts, but only 61 passing yards. That's a huge surprise when you have the weapons at tight end and Rod Smith, who's able to put up some big numbers.
4 receiver look, Greasy. Under some heat again, Caron Coleman, the running back, is spun down at the 38-yard line by Chuki Wakori. It's a 7-yard gain, but the clock is moving. Under 30 seconds to go now, first half.
Yeah, Greasy does a good job getting rid of the ball. He was under pressure, but still was able to deliver the ball very accurately on that play.
From the 38, Greasy guns it, incomplete. Coleman had a chance to turn that one upfield and gain valuable yardage. Sam Sword making the play on that far side.
Sam Sword getting the chance to play for the middle linebacker, Rod Morris, who's out with an injury. But watch Sword. He's able to stay with him very quick. Actually, that ball is dropped. He should have made the catch there. Coleman should have made the catch because Sword was a step behind Coleman. Ball hitting right in the hands.
Now a third and three, only 18 seconds left here in the first half. Indianapolis, they have dropped seven of their last eight. They're trying to finish the year at 6-10 following the embarrassing loss to St. Louis last week. Marshall fought four touchdowns. Greasy across the middle. He's got a first down to Rod Smith and able to get out of bounds with 12 seconds left to go.
Yeah, they're going to need another big play in order to get in range for a field goal, because right now they're just a little bit on the other side of the 50-yard line. But Rod Smith is the crosser coming underneath. This pass has been open all day because he's caught several of these today. He's able to not only make the catch and pick up some yards, but he's also able to get out of bounds and stop the clock.
Denver does have two timeouts left. They have 12 seconds remaining on the clock. Need at least another 15 yards. Elam does have a big leg, as we know. He's the record holder along with Dempsey. It's irrelevant now. Bratsky. Another sack for Chad Bratsky. Brian Greasy just took a huge loss.
Yeah, and Bratsky's able to beat the left tackle, Trey T, coming off that side. And it's just his speed. He's told you, he said he was going to come out and play hard. He was going to go home feeling good about himself and this football team. You see him beating Teague and coming from the blind side, getting the sack on Greasy.
7 seconds now remain, first half.
Well, Chad Bratsky really let the local members of the media have it when they criticized the defensive line for the woes of this defense. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that later.
Greasy throwing into coverage, and the catch is made by Smith. Time trickling away, and they run out of time here at the end of the second quarter unless they got that timeout in.
1 second.
They're going to put 1 second on the clock.
And the fans here at the RCA Dome, they're not happy about it because the clock read all zeros. Jim Mora's not happy either.
Turns out to be a 20-yard play. And we're looking at about a 54-yard attempt for Jason Elam. And yeah, there's Greasy calling the timeout, trying to get the attention of the referee, Winter.
As soon as the catch was made, Greasy was signaling for the timeout, trying to save some time on the clock so they can line up, kick a field goal. Really go a long way in helping their cause to get back into the game.
Well, we know Jason Elam is capable. Broncos all-time leading scorer, going to the Pro Bowl for the third time. And he has made 18 of his last 19 attempts. This from 54 yards away. Ruin will hold it. Diaz and Fonte will snap it. Trying to put three on the board before the end of the first half. Jason Elam. No good. Denver had an opportunity, but Elam unable to cash in from 54 yards. End of the first half. Indy with a 19-7 lead over Denver.